I started in a very humble way. I was just telling some time ago that 20 years ago, I was just wandering on the Chowpatty beach, just thinking that what would I do once I was just doing my schooling that time. My sister was living in one slum area in Malad. So I was just trying hard to do something in my life. And starting from there and then standing in front of you is a great journey I had. I don't know how to share with you. Yeah, I hope so. So it's an amazing journey. I never looked back. I think only mantra I had was I was struggling all the time. I think that struggle has taken me to this place. So I have no words to tell about whatever has been happening to me. It's a great day for me. And for this to happen, Srinivasanji is the first person I like to thank. And ORF is the organization which has given me this honor. Feel rather very privileged to speak on the podium where the Nobel laureates have actually spoken. It's a great feeling. I would assure you that when you leave this hall, you feel that you are a proud Indian while you are leaving this hall. This much I can definitely assure you. The reason being, of course, a person who is standing in front of you starting with such a humble background. Same thing happened when I joined the Chandrayaan project. So from there, what we have achieved, you would certainly see that if you can dream, you can actually achieve it. Here is the example, living example. So I'm sure that I look up to the moon. The moment I look at the moon, I feel that the baby which I developed is there on the moon. And that feeling, I just can't tell you. For that feeling, I ran with aluminum block on my shoulder, with magnesium huge block, almost 30 kilograms. On my shoulder I was carrying 3 years ago, because there is no bureaucracy in ISRO. You have to get your work done. But I have no regrets for whatever I have worked hard, because I have got the results. I'm standing today here. I think every step I have taken with that aluminum block has been paid off. I feel great. After the success of Pokhran, the Indian think tank, they wanted to do something spectacular. So they wanted to do something in which, how should we say that as an Indian you should feel proud of? Imagine that these ideas were thought over, and in fact I'm very pleased to hear that Prime Minister Vajpayee's close associate or a person whom worked there has been here. I'm very honored, because it was in 2003, August 15th, it was declared that we would go to the moon. So though the idea of going to the moon was actually to tell the nation that if we determine something, we will be able to achieve it. So the idea was thrown at ISRO. So the think tank went back to ISRO and said that, can you do it? Then it seems in late 90s, I was just reading about some historical developments of Chandrayaan's story. There they were saying that Kasturi Rangan was almost thinking that something like this would come on the way. So he used to sit with his best brains in ISRO and say that tomorrow, if the question is thrown to us, that is going to the moon, can we do it? So there was some backup plan going on at the back. So they had actually worked out the details with whatever technology they have and said that, can we do it? So the moment it was actually thrown the idea at the scientist, ISRO embraced that idea with no problems whatsoever. So that's how the ISRO has taken that idea, and let's just see how they have accomplished it. Today's, normally what I have been giving is, I have been giving popular talks either on a thing called Chandrayaan 1, which would only be dealing details of Chandrayaan 1, or I would actually talk about Moon Impact Probe, or let's say I would give a technical talk on CHASE instrument, which we have developed. Whenever I talk about CHASE instrument, I would also talk about the results we have got. When I was talking to the organizers here, they said that you put everything together. Now, in the pursuit of putting everything together, the only request I have to the organizers and to the audience is, if you can pay attention to the 45 slides I have got, I can really take you through the entire story, and I would not make it boring. It's going to be very interesting, and I will come down to the level at which everybody should understand. And there are a lot of snippets, a lot of interesting stories. If time permits and depending on the space I'm going, pace I'm going, I will be divulging in some of the stories. So this is what I'm going to cover. So ultimately, I will end with the results which the instrument has got, that is the instrument which I worked on. I would also be touching upon all the instruments which are there in Chandrayaan, under Chandrayaan. Now let's see, what is the secret behind Chandrayaan's success? Why we have got so much of success? You see, what is happening here is the Apple satellite being carried out on a bullock cart. Now you see that Chandrayaan is being carried out by the satellite tracked and with CSF guarding, and also you can see the liquid nitrogen is being used, because to be able to keep the NASA's payload called Moon Mineralogy Mapper, it was to be actually flushed with liquid nitrogen at minus 190 degrees centigrade. So the liquid nitrogen tank is also there. So from there to such a great level of sophistication it has come. What is it? If you like to ask that question, I have an answer, because I was part of the system. So what they do is the following. They have an unbiased selection of the project. So normally in the case of Chandrayaan, the idea came from none other than the Prime Minister himself. Of course, so there is no question of debating whether somebody has influenced that you do X or Y type of work. Now, they have thorough assessment by experts. In red, it is called EXT, that is external experts. They don't actually call their own, let's say, friends who will come and pat them and say, you're doing extremely well. They call the people who can actually, all my payload was completely assessed by a gentleman called Professor Agarwal, who is an authority in TAF or professor in space-borne instrumentation. He has always told me all my three important reviews that this instrument will never work. And you know, because he has told that the instrument will never work, I worked so hard that I wanted to prove him wrong. So I feel extremely today happy, but I also respect Professor Agarwal, because with whatever interest he has said, just only to make my instrument better and better. So I have no complaints on whatever he said. It's completely an unbiased way of criticizing. They criticize a lot, and it worked for me and for ISRO it will work. Now, right to ask. RTS means not RTA, it is right to ask. Hierarchy is completely ignored. Nobody would say that, even to the chairman of ISRO, otherwise who is regarded as a god in ISRO, but a very junior engineer can stand up and ask a question, sir, I disagree with you, and I don't really agree that this will work this way. This is what I have seen things happening in Jet Propulsion Lab also, but it works here in ISRO also, which lot of people don't know. At the same time, there's a underlying hierarchy, but that is worked with some other difference, so I would not like to go into the details. Responsibility, both in success and failure. I was told that President Kalam, when he was the project director of ASLV, it seems, in fact, I met some people who were actually part of ASLV. They were saying that whenever ASLV actually failed, so President Kalam took all the responsibility that we ran, maybe we fumbled there, we did some mistake here, like that. He took all the failure. When the next mission, when it went off properly, then it seems he was standing right at the back, and he let all his junior people, including Madhavan Nair, to go and get the prizes, awards. So that way, right from the beginning of the space program, he has shown that if there is a problem, if there is a failure, you accept it as a team. So that's how they do. In fact, that's a great deal. And also, they will, responsibility they feel. These are the places where I am asked to tell a story. The story here is, now all this is done by a very strong agency called QA. QA is a very, very strong agency, quality and assurance. And I used to be very, very scared of quality assurance. I'll just give you an example. That is the detector setting. We wrote the documents, everything is all ready, the instrument is ready to go. At the last moment, I changed the operational voltage of the detector from, let's say, a value of 1800 volts to 2000 volts. Then there is a person called deputy director rank, who's a very supreme authority in the center. He's a deputy director heading the quality assurance. That gentleman came to my room, which is very rare, and said that, why have you changed the voltage? Then I was working with a boss who has got a green chit from the chairman of ISRO, saying that my guys will do whatever they feel like, nobody should ask questions. That actually means QA guy should also not ask a question. But here is a QA man, a deputy director, coming up to a manager who's a okay guy. I mean, he's not a very big guy. So, now why I change the voltage? I wrote to a person who has actually worked in Apollo mission, and he has said that if you want to go for the best bet, since your instrument is lasting only for the 20 minutes, just go for it, because 1800 is actually the higher most voltage one should go for. 2000 volts, if you run the instrument for some more time, the instrument would have actually got roasted. Now, here is the case where I am actually saying that I am ready to roast my instrument. Then the quality guy will ask that, why do you want to roast your instrument? Now, the reason I want to roast my instrument is, I want to go for the best possible sensitivity. Let's try to get the best out of it. And the instrument would not get roasted. Who told me this? I got an email from US. Now, the quality deputy director says, can you show me the email? Now, my boss, under whom I directly worked, I said that he has told me that don't ever show anything to anybody. I got a green thing. Nobody can question you. Now, with this guy, because in the field, I'm a frontline soldier, and my commander is nothing but QA deputy director. So I had shown the email to him. The moment he saw the email, I'm very happy with you. Let's go ahead. So what I'm trying to say is, here is the case where the QA person is allowing me to do something very nasty, which is against ISRO's QA norms, only by holding the thing called responsibility. He wants to hold responsibility that I am part of this, even though I am allowing this guy to do it, but I am also responsible. If by any chance my instrument had got roasted, I am sure the deputy director would have helped me, because that is the culture. So it's very important that this is how we work. So I just wanted to show you, tell you that these kind of things are very important things, because of which the instrument worked extremely well. Now, let's see, I just want to ask a question then, why do you want to go to the moon? There has always been a human quest to, let us see, go to the nearest the stellar body, and to explore what it is. So the moment the first satellite was launched by Russia, within couple of years, I think it was 57, Sputnik was launched. So couple of years, they said that they tried to go to the moon. And you see, they have been trying. And if you see the history, what all has happened, historically, red standing for Russia, no guess, it's red for Russia, and then blue for America. Russia was doing extremely well. You see, first lunar flyby, and then first hard landing, first close-up TV, first soft landing, everything was done by Russia until the first human landed on the moon. The moment Neil Armstrong landed on the moon, it was US actually which has taken over from Russia. But the idea is, though, I'm not just trying to do any politicizing here, but trying to tell you that it was also Russia which has actually been doing wonderful job in the exploration of moon and in various other fields also. But eventually, anyway, it was US post Apollo program which was doing extremely well. So there was always a inquisitiveness among humans to go to the moon. Now, why a lunar mission for a country like India? Why do we have to go? Because I gave a lot of talks in Kerala. Kerala being a country with left government working there and people having a lot of ideas, they would ask me dozens of questions that, sir, why do you want to spend so much of money? So today it has become extremely simple for me to give explanation, because there are thousands of crores of scams going on. I am talking only about 386. I am talking about 386 crores. So not a problem, but I'm just trying to see why do we do that? See, there are a lot of spin-off technologies which are come. So Godrej has been doing a lot of job for ISRO. Godrej, all the space vehicle launch vehicle program was 70% of the program is outsourced to Godrej. Godrej is doing, L&T is doing. There are a lot of many small scale industries. I come from Hyderabad. A lot of people from AP, retired, post-retired ISRO engineers are actually doing a thing called space-borne hardening of electronics equipment. So it is a very involved task until unless you are very well trained. I'll just give you a glimpses of what that actually means when I go into my instrument. So those outsourcing all is done in Hyderabad, and those guys are making a lot of money. So there are a lot of spin-off technologies. It's not that I want to take a rocket and I will only study the moon, take few pictures of the moon. It's not that way. Lot of other industries are also flourishing. Regeneration in the young minds. APJ Abdul Kalam comes there again. The reason being that it was President Kalam's idea, in a way, that since we are having a maddening rush for going for IT and nobody wants to do science, and as India, like a country which is doing so much in science, let us divert the young minds, bring them there. So ISRO, who was getting only 50,000-60,000 applications for 1,000 employees they take every year, now they are getting lakhs of applications just to hire 1,000 employees. The idea has worked wonderfully well. Now, unique business opportunities. I just put Russia, Belarus, and Israel. Russia actually is doing a lot of laser work. Lasers are developed. Belarus is also developing some, defense type of lasers. Israel, of course, we all know that all types of defense equipment Israel is doing. In niche areas, they are making millions, billions of dollars. Now, the unique business opportunity for ISRO, there is a thing called Anthrix. Anthrix is the business arm of ISRO. That has actually got 3 times the business in last few years. And it has a turnover has actually reached 1,000 crores, which started with a very small beginning. So, I attended a conference in Italy, where one paper was presented there. The European agency was trying to say that in the next decade or 2 decades, if humans were to be taken to the moon, which is the best bet, which is the most economical and most reliable way of going? They said PSLV is the most reliable vehicle and the cheapest. So it is because of that they are saying, so if that is true, maybe in the next decades we are having a huge business coming on our way. Now, national pride. We were the 4th nation actually to have our object going to the moon after those 3 nations. Now, this is Chandrayaan spacecraft. There are a lot of things written. Don't have to worry about those. Just pay your attention. I'll tell you SAR-2, LLRI, TMC. These are the payloads which are sitting at different locations. All these are aiming at the lunar surface, HEX, and then HIC, MINISAR. Only thing I like to tell you is, it's a 1.5 meter honeycomb structure, which is very, very light. And just I'll take you to the next. Okay, important thing I wanted to tell is, this is Chandrayaan. Moon impact probe is sitting right here. On moon impact probe, there is a small tube protruding out. It's called CHASE. I'll just show you the picture, actual picture. This is the actual picture of Chandrayaan spacecraft. And this is the moon impact probe. CHASE instrument is a white tubular section which is protruding out. This is a CHASE. The Chandrayaan as such was 1,400 kilograms when it was lifted off, or when it was in the launch vehicle. After it reached the moon, it was carrying 650 kilograms. The payloads were only 110 kilograms. It's a very small amount you were actually given. That actually means that every screw if you're putting, instead of 3 mm, which is a specified size, if you want to say that I want to put a screw of 5 mm, I have to give an answer to my project director that why I'm using 2 mm extra screw, because that would lead to few milligrams of extra weight. So it's extremely difficult that whatever you carry to the moon is so important, because that is the weight you get. And then it's very important, I just wanted to tell, it's a part of education to the people. If you can go back and home and tell that, today I learned that how we reach the moon to your children, I'm very happy. Because this I have always been telling in all the presentations. So PSLV being the workhorse of our ISRO, it has done a wonderful job of taking it to 256 kilometers. And 22,000 apogee. So PSLV has done the job extremely well. And now every time when it comes to the perigee, liquid apogee motors were fired, and then the orbit raising took place. So the orbit raising took place, EO1, EO2, EO3. So there was a small story here, is that when Chandrayaan was to take place, here is the case where how quickly a system can react. Otherwise, it may appear as if that, let's say in ISRO, there are people like, you may call them babus, who won't really work harder. I mean, those guys, they won't wake up. Here is the case, typical case in which they felt that their mission is threatened. And the threat came from none other than in the international internet. Let me use the word internet, not the media. It is the internet, as a matter of fact. Was that internet, there was a propaganda saying that the Chandrayaan would never reach moon. Why? Because Chandrayaan is actually using NASA's programs in reaching the moon, and there is a thing called solar flux correction. So as the spacecraft is heading in an orbit, and let's say the sun is somewhere here, solar flux will give a push. If you don't account for the push properly, what you would do is you will go for a very critical operation called lunar insertion orbit. And it is here the Ranger program of NASA, before actually going on to the Apollo program, out of the 9 attempts, 6 attempts were failed, because either they do a overcorrection, then they are lost in the space. If they don't correct very properly for the solar flux, then they will never be captured by the moon.
So lunar insertion orbit was a very important operation. And so since the people saw that this is happening, so instead of going in three attempts, Earth orbit raising attempts, ISRO realized that let's not do it since there is something going on here. So we will try to recalibrate every time. What you do is you fire the LAM, liquid apogee motor, and see that since you have fired this much, what is your eventual this thing orbit. Then second time you fire again, what is your orbit? Orbit raising is taking place. But as you fire higher and higher, you are actually stretching the orbit so much that if you don't correct for the solar flux properly, you would have either lost in the space or you would not have reached the moon at all. If you miss the moon in that attempt, you will never be able to capture by the moon. So your mission is gone. So it is to the people whom they question me means to ISRO, that how successful is Chandrayaan project, whether it is 60%, 40%, 70%, 80%. I think I would like to enter into the debate and say that being captured by the moon itself was a great success for a country like India. That's what I just like to say. So we got captured by the moon. That was a great success. And then eventually whatever has happened is amazing. Though I get my salary from human resources development, I don't get from ISRO. But I'm just trying to impress upon you people that how intricate was the problem and how difficult it was and how we achieved it. Okay. Now, let me just come back to the instruments which were carried by the moon, Chandrayaan. So there were foreign payloads. They were also called, I got two stories to tell, which are very short. One is called Opportunity Payload Section. So the ISRO scientists never went for their friends. Let's say I know one guy in, let's say, Jet Propulsion Lab or Goddard Space Flight Center. Let me give him a chance to bring his instrument. It's nothing. It never happened like that. How it happened then? There was a committee of five eminent scientists. Couple from ISRO and a couple from TFR and some other places. These people sat down and they selected the best possible instruments which are actually ready to go. They are just ready. So there are a couple of instruments which Moon Mineralogy Mapper and the other one from Brown University and the other one from Naval Research Lab, they were ready to go for the exploration of Mars. And those guys were saying that the Indians are calling us. So they actually came into the foray. The moment they did, ISRO realized that these are the best instruments. They are just there, waiting in their arms. So they just grabbed them. So one of the best credit why we can give it to ISRO is because of the unbiased selection of opportunity payloads. So, and then, ISRO did not just call them and then for the heck of calling and then use them as a black box. Instead of doing that, they collaborated. So wherever you see Indian flag along with the foreign flag, that actually means ISRO also collaborated. In a way, ISRO learned also. So that's how it has happened. Now let's just go through the instruments. Chandrayaan X-ray spectrometer, CHICS, smart infrared spectrometer, of course, flags, you know, Britain and India, collaborative. German did allow us to collaborate. And then Swedish SARA collaborated. In fact, my colleagues at Vikram Sarabhai Space Center collaborated. They did a wonderful job. And Radome is from Bulgaria. It's a small instrument. There is no room for collaboration. But it did a wonderful job because in all European missions, Bulgaria was giving the X-ray dosimeter, it's called. So it worked extremely well from Bulgaria. Of course, US, Brown University Moon Mineralogy Mapper, already ready to go. There was no scope for collaboration. And then Mini Synthetic Aperture Radar, again ready to go. So there was no scope for collaboration. So that's what has happened. Six payloads. Now, Indian payloads. Just like to say that even though India was aspiring to go to space, India wanted to do, just from this slide you'll be able to make out that how ill-equipped India was, because they had no manpower to have people who can actually design good experiments and take payloads. So a guy like me, I have never worked on space-borne instrumentation. I worked only in the lab. I have done a lot of lab-based experiments. So When somebody proposed my name, and then I met Chairman ISRO, he said that gentleman says that you're good at experiments. So if you can deliver goods, then come to us. So I just got an opportunity like that. So you see that India, let's go through these. Terrain mapping camera, hyperspectral imager, lunar laser ranging instruments, LLRI, high energy X-ray spectrometer, moon impact probe. Just like to say something that if you look at the Indian payloads, mostly they are camera based. If you see that from our IRS heritage, from our remote sensing, ISRO is very strong in imagery. So you can see that cameras are there. The hyperspectral imager also in a way for imaging the vegetation, etc. It's kind of a spectrograph. And high energy X-ray spectrometer, yes. But I like to give full credits to serial numbers 3 and 5. 3 is for the first time ISRO trying to build a laser based instrument and to be able to take it to the space and make sure that it works. LEOs, I think once I go to the instrument, I'll show you. They have done it. Moon impact probe, as I have been just telling, is a unique experience. They made it work. I'll just come back to those later. Now, let's just see what exactly they are doing. They are doing chemical mapping. Who are all doing chemical mapping? X-ray spectrometer and high energy X-ray spectrometer. Mineralogy mapper, hyperspectral imager, and SIR to moon mineralogy mapper. Then topography mapping, LLRI and terrain mapping camera. Radiation environment, radome, hex and chicks. Magnetic field mapping, volatile transport and lunar atmospheric constituent. It is done in by MIP and none other than our instrument. And those people who are having spectral this thing knowledge also, I just like to say that in the history of exploration of the moon, there has never been a time that the entire electromagnetic spectrum, starting from radio waves to almost to the other end gamma waves, has been covered by any mission like that. So that way also it's a great mission that what all has been covered, you see, everything has been covered. Then charged particles were measured and then neutral particles were measured. So whatever could be possible in the history of space exploration, it has all been accommodated by Chandrayaan. Now, let's just see the foreign payloads. The Chandrayaan X-ray spectrometer is from UK, as I told. It's basically an X-ray spectrometer working in the X-ray wavelengths of this, primarily looking for magnesium, aluminum, silicon, iron and titanium. The German infrared spectrometer also, again a mineralogy tracer, trying to look for mineralogy mapping. Similarly, foreign payloads, SARA is a unique experiment. Actually, it is now going in a mission called Baby Colomb to Mars. That is also to look for neutral particles which are actually reflected from the surface of any stellar body. In the case of here, it is in the case of Moon. Just interestingly, like to tell you something here. These are the sensors made by Sweden, Switzerland, Japan. So three countries involved in making the sensors. The data acquisition and power supply is made in Vikram Sarabhai Space Center. So it's a unique experience in which no matter what kind of detectors you have, no matter what kind of demand you have, I will provide you the power, I will provide you the data acquisition system. Whatever data type you have, it's a very complex handshake in which you have to give a power and also control the data and record the data. Those people who are involved in instrumentation, they can appreciate that how complex it is. And a country like India has done such an excellent job and it worked. So that is a great achievement, I must say. And radome, as I was saying, is just like a small cassette level, small instrument, which is built in, everything is built in. Power supply, detection system, data acquisition from a country which is known for boxing, Bulgaria. Okay, now here are the very important, significant instruments from NASA. Mini Synthetic Aperture Radar. This is a very unique and most sophisticated instruments ever to be flown in space. It actually sends the microwaves. It's called active probing. It sends the microwave and then try to see whatever is buried few inches beneath the ground. So in the lunar craters in southern and northern pole, it was expected that a lot of ice has been buried. So this is the best way actually to probe for water. This was the number one contender to say that whether water is there or not. But however, Moon Mineralogy Mapper, which was developed at Brown University, again going all the way, the beauty of this instrument is going all the way up to 3 microns. If you recall the hyperspectral imager and the German SISR2, those instruments were going only up to 2.5 micron. So there is a great deal of instrumentation involved from 2.4 to 3 micron because the detection system, you need a complete revamping of detection system from 2.5 to 3 micron. And then also the noise is so much and there are a lot of experimental problems involved there. So Brown University had solved all those problems and the instrument was catching dust in their racks. So the Chandrayaan people said that this is the best way to grab them. They grabbed it and it has done a wonderful job. Moon Mineralogy Mapper. Now, let's come back to the Indian payloads. Terrain mapping camera was developed at SAC Ahmedabad, and it was a topography. For the first time in the history of lunar exploration, 5-meter resolution topographic images have a look at the images, a stunning image it has given. And of course, it's a very small in size, and you look at the image it has given with a 3D view and giving a 5-meter resolution. Similarly, hyperspectral imager from SAC, it is an infrared spectrometer, and it gives 80-meter resolution, and these are 64 bands, again, mainly looking for mineralogy. Lunar laser ranging instrument, look at this number, very, very attractive, 5-meter height resolution is an amazing resolution one can look for, 5-meter, because of which you will be able to see complete greater details. And not only that, there are thing called gravitational field anomaly. So moon is known to, it's not a very solid body like Earth, and it has a nice gravity all along. There are a lot of gravitational anomalies. So if the spacecraft is revolving around the moon, wherever there are hollow patches of gravity, it will just get a jerk. That jerk, if it gets, I know very well that I have set it to, let's say, 97.82 kilometers orbit. Instead of 97.82, even if it goes 5 meters here and there, I'll be able to say, well, there is an anomaly. So like that, so that kind of job is what it is accomplished. High energy X-ray spectrometer, again, first time effort by R&D institutes, is the mother of ISRO, Physical Research Laboratory, where I did my PhD. These people are also trying to prove a conjecture in which the particles would, if the high energy particles move from equator to the pole, there is a conjecture which says that similarly the water also would have actually got to the north or south pole and buried there. This is to prove the water presence, at the same time trying to look for uranium and thorium. Okay, what did we get from Chandrayaan at the cost of 386 crores? We got our tricolor, see the same thing on the moon. We found Hydrus moon, the science carried. Science is the mother of all journals now, almost surpassed Nature also. It has carried the top front page saying that the moon all has been explored. So much near side. All has been explored. The blue portion is all water. The green portion is less indicative of water. And the all orange and red is indicative of some other species. Spectacular 3D images from the moon at 5-meter resolution. And mineralogy maps at 5-meter resolution, 80% covered. There seems to be a debate that it is not 80%. But however, I can definitely say that you see, it's all, so much is covered, but in the press, 70 to 80% had come. It seems to be a less number. I won't go into the debate. First time a global effort. Actually, I got an award when I attended a conference in Lunar Exploration Working Group in Italy. They gave an award that for the first time a country like India is demonstrated that how to do a global research from a country like India. So we got an award from all the international exploration group. We are at par with the leaders in space. We are ready to step on Mars. Okay, now I will drift into Moon Impact Probe. In Moon Impact Probe, the idea was to, the red is the Chandrayaan mother spacecraft, green is the Moon Impact Probe. So the moment you reach the 100 kilometer polar orbit, get rid of the dead weight. So whenever I was attending the conferences in Bangalore, the people were they were very sore at Moon Impact Probe, because in fact, the idea of having a Moon Impact Probe was also not so much welcomed by the core group of Chandrayaan, because they were thinking that, well, 30 kilograms you have to carry. What if the separation doesn't take place? So there was a guy who had a lot of sleepless nights who was to actually deliver a job of separation. So this guy had successfully done 3 to 4 separations very well in the satellites. But the question was whether that separation technique will work in the deep space called moon environment. So I'm sure he had a lot of problems, but the strict guidelines and the quality assurance was so strong, they almost tried to repeat this process in a space. Space is actually, space I mean, let me just tell you something. We are taking breath and we are enjoying this atmosphere, because we are enjoying in a very heavy atmosphere called 760 tar of air, 760 tar. Whereas on the moon, and 760 tar actually means those people will mass will just raise their eyebrows. 10 raised to 19 particles per cubic centimeter. My nostril, 1 cubic centimeter, is carrying 10 raised to 19 particles. 10 raised to 5 is 1 lakh. So many lakhs of nitrogen, oxygen I am taking in, I am taking out. So much of particles are there, 760. So the instrument will work beautifully. So if this laptop is working, it works beautifully here. The moment you take it to the airplane and just take it out of the window, if you happen to, this would never work, because there the pressure is so less, the temperature is different. So we are talking about a isolated separation system to be able to work on the moon at 10 raised to minus 10 torr. So 10 raised to 19 particles I am breathing here. On moon I find only 10 raised to 5 particles. I am talking about a difference of 10 raised to 14. 10 raised to 14 is a huge difference. 10 raised to 14. So 10 raised to 14 difference, can your mechanism work? I have absolute no idea. That guy, his head was spinning, because the project director would ask him that, will it work? He said, sir, it should work. He said, okay, what if, then the question was, let's take it to the vacuum. So 760 torr, then 0 torr, 10 raised to minus 1 torr, minus 2 torr, minus 3 torr. There is a thing called a rotary pump which can easily take to 10 raised to minus 3 torr. 10 raised to minus 3 torr separating, sir, no problem. Then he said 10 raised to minus 6 torr, yes, there is one pump called turbo molecular pump. You pay 20 lakhs rupees, you get a pump called turbo molecular. 10 raised to minus 6 torr separating, sir. Now, I would like to ask question, 10 raised to minus 7 torr, I have absolute no idea. Even NASA has not done any experiments in 10 raised to minus 7, minus 8 torr. All those people who have instruments experience will say, they will just say that there are a lot of, when I achieve 10 raised to minus 10 torr in Trivandrum, one of the guys who had come as a technical expert said, on the soil of Trivandrum, first time would have seen 10 raised to minus 10 torr. Because that's what I have to show, that the instrument will work at 10 raised to minus 10 torr. Anyway, so separation system was very extremely difficult. It has to get separated, it would have got separated, and then it should spin also on its own. It has to spin to get the stability, and then finally it would have an impact. So if I am having a polar orbit like that on the moon, I would get separated. Moon impact probe would get separated here, and then it would fly and it will come down all along. It is actually coming down also, and then it will have an impact at the southern pole. So what the MIP mission was, we will switch on the instruments 20 minutes before we get separated. That is, if I am maybe almost when I was behind the moon, I got separated. I have switched on my instrument and then I got separated here. Then I got 22 minutes of ride. My instrument, our instrument on MIP worked for 20 plus 22. 42 minutes they have worked. 20 plus 22. And the ground coverage was 2800 kilometers from here to here. The place we had an impact at southern pole, Aitken region they call, this is the exact place just away from Malapad mountains in southern pole. This is the actual picture taken by Apollo or maybe the lunar prospector images. We had an impact there, and that was on 14th November 2008, southern pole 87 degrees south. We call it Jawahar Point because of Panditji's birthday that day, 14th November. Now see, look at these are the first color pictures ever taken on the moon as we were heading towards the moon, 100 kilometers. This was the image. See, just we were very, very away, and then we were getting closer. These are the raw pictures which I have not done anything. I was there when the data was coming. I copied the data when it reached the day, the moment it reached. So these are unaltered, no image processing was done. So you have to pardon me for the slight this thing. He's just come because of the data compression and then retrieving the data back, 40 kilometers. And this is, you see, the moon is at the other end. You can see the crater. You can see the crater, and you see the shadow of the crater. It's 25 kilometers. Now, I will drift. I will come down to interior of MIP called Chase. Chase Chandra's altitudinal composition explorer. Chase developed at Vikram Sarabhai Space Center. In a unit, there is a center. In a center, there could be a unit, and my unit where I work called Space Physics Laboratory. It's a science think tank of ISRO in a way. Apart from Physical Research Laboratory, which is the mother of all subjects, in Space Physics Laboratory, we'll do research only, academic research only pertaining to space. Whereas Physical Research Laboratory Ahmedabad does everything from oceans to space, including astronomy. It was done there. Just as she was mentioning, the idea of showing this picture is not to glorify my team members, only to say that these are all very young guys, barring my boss, who has space-borne instrumentation. All the other guys, just including their degrees also, you can see, we were only dare to dream. Our boss will ask us to jump, we will jump into the bell. Wherever he asks, we'll jump. So that is what, with that experience we started off. And these were the people. The guy who has contributed the most with me was this guy, with M.Tech from Kolkata. And tons of energy he has. So with that only, we could actually do a lot. Okay, now let's just see what do we want to do. As I was just telling, what do we know about Earth and Moon? We know about Earth, 760 torr, for 10 raised to 5 particles per cc, just now I told. We know air means nitrogen, oxygen. So what do we know about Moon? Actually, literally we knew nothing about Moon when we were to actually go. Why? Because we know that there's absolute vacuum, nobody was interested. I mean, they said that let's not worry about it, because it's just 10 raised to minus 10 torr, here 760 torr. Composition, do we know composition? Yes. There was some barely known, one guy by name Alan Stern. I was in touch with him while I was developing my instrument. Alan Stern has reviewed one article about everything the humanity knows about lunar composition or what is there in the moon. So that person, his review article says that it's only helium, neon, hydrogen molecule and argon. This is all the humanity knew before Chase was going. Then guys in Trivandrum would ask me, then why are you going? Why are you building this instrument? Why do you want to take it to the moon? Then we said that since anyway you are actually carrying 20 plus kilograms to the moon, why don't you carry 2 more kilograms? We'll just put our instrument and we'll see. So that's how we were actually not quite invited in Moon Impact Probe. But thanks to my boss Sridharanji, he was always saying that we will do something. And I just didn't carry one slide where I was always showing that there is a scope for finding water on the southern pole. That slide I have been showing for the last 6 years. I didn't carry it now today. So to be able to do this work, what do you do? We had a challenge of finding some instrument which can actually work in 10 raised to minus 10 tau. So if you want to go into that ambience, do you have something? Yes, there is a solution. We found the solution. And I'm sorry, this is not tritium, this is helium-3. I made a mistake. So what do we have to do? Our mission goes for very simple and straightforward. Study the lunar ambience and look for water. This is not the slide I am saying. I actually had another slide which is very close to my heart, because I have been showing for 6 years and I was saying that I would look for water, and eventually we found something there. So water, and then it's not tritium, it's actually helium-3. So same thing I am saying, that we should find an instrument. There is an instrument which is possible, 1 to 100 atomic mass unit, and it will have an electron multiplier as a detector. It would actually go down to a value called 10 raised to minus 14 torr. Amazing sensitivity, available only in the past 4 to 5 years in the international market. And it will work at 24 volts. More than that, how much power it will take? 24 watts. Reasonably manageable. Otherwise, the mission guys would have said, get lost. Because if I say, I want 50 watts, they'll say, okay, well, I don't have. So, in fact, they were saying, can you work within 20 watts? So we just managed the sir 4 more watts. So they said, okay, you are in. Like that, and the weight also is very important, 2.3 kilograms. That was also hurting them a lot, because they were saying anything below 2 kilograms is allowed. So we are saying 2.3 kilograms. So debate went on and they said, we will give you 2 years. In 2 years, if you succeed in say showing that the instrument is doing well, we will allow you, otherwise you are out. What are we supposed to do? We have to characterize the instrument. We do the ruggedization. It's not an English word, but it's a coined by ISRO. Ruggedization. It's an ISRO word. So, I'm perfectly happy with it, because it's a ISRO's word. Data acquisition and control is a very difficult job. I'll tell you what it is. And then the color is slightly becoming darker and darker. When it becomes extremely red, that actually means your life is hell. So to be able to pass this actually means it's extremely red. I'll tell you how red it is, right? Then if you cross all this, you will come up with a beautiful baby called flight model of Chase. And this is what it is. So let's just, my idea here is not to take you through the cumbersome procedures, what all we did, but I'll just try to touch upon some of the very difficult experiences we went through, and I just take for 5 minutes or so, but not to bore you that, well, I did this, and then I tightened these screws, I tightened this. I mean, I don't want to say this, but just enjoy what we did. You see? Yeah, I can actually, if you say, I'll take another 1 hour to cover the next 15 transferences, but it's your choice. So, characterization was done. How? 10 raised to minus 10 tau achieved. How? Pfeiffer vacuum pump from Germany. One of the best in its category. And the instrument was there. We almost 24 hours, 7 days, 13 days. There is a snake at the bottom because it was so difficult. I was just living outside the ISRO colony and I had to come on my cycle. And the instrument is on all along 24 hours. Normally ISRO guys close their lab at 5 o'clock. They are not supposed to work after 5. Only a director, center director gives an permission, then only you can get into the system. So I have to bite down, and there are so many snakes in those monsoon years. I am very scared of snakes actually. So a thing called viper snake from Kerala means, it's in Malayalam they call ettadagu, means 8 feet also you can't cross once it bites you. So I was always worried about those 8 feet if I have to survive. Fortunately, I wiped down on many snakes actually, which were either dead, and some live snakes also went up. I'm not trying to make a story, but it's there. So it's a very serene area on the banks of Indian Ocean, where nobody can go, and ISRO has been occupying this from President Kalam's time, and it's a beautiful area. It's very green, there are a lot of palm trees, but barring that, you have to be careful. Of course, I don't treat them as enemies, but it's their land, we are occupying. So successfully, we have achieved 10 raised to minus 10 torque, and we said that yes, the instrument can have so much of juice, sensitivity, that the signal is so beautiful. You see, this is the lab spectrum. Atomic mass unit 1 to 100, 18 means water, 28 means nitrogen, N2, CO2 at 44. Everything is there. The instrument worked, the team, my project director was very happy. He said that, yes, you have some respect in my eyes now. Now, so after that, though only the first step, I have to cross this also. So a lot of, pardon me for ruggedization, electronics. So we have to reinforce, we have to make electronics strong. So what they told us is, there is a thing called a heritage in ISRO. So if I am from Indian Remote Sensing Satellite heritage, I am a man with lot of respect. Today, I am a man with tremendous respect because I am a chase heritage I carry. So what people told me is, you follow the heritage called IRS heritage. What is that IRS heritage? You have to replacement of weak components, if at all they are there, replace them with space qualified components. Then there is heat sink epoxy. There are a lot of places where components are producing heat, you have to soak, take the heat away. So there are a lot of epoxy which is heat sink. There are a lot of protecting memory chips from radiation. When you are going from Earth to the Moon, there is a thing called Van Allen belts. You have to actually cross Van Allen belts, where there are a lot of huge amount of charge particles through which you have to go past, you have to pass by. So until unless your chips are protected from them, you will never be able to cross. So this was a completely grey area, which IRS heritage also was also not having any information. So only NASA had some restricted information, and I managed to barge into some of my friends, and through their emails, I got more information. And of course, I must give credit to ISRO. ISRO also had planned, because once you go for geosynchronous orbit and you want to protect your actually memory, you don't want to hurt your ROMs, which are very beautifully programmed. You don't want your rooms to go bad. So from that, and of course, we never had crossed, let's say, a thing called few lakhs of kilometers from Earth. So all the reinforcement went in, and it did work well. Now, ruggedization to mechanical. So if you are falling on Earth, you are spared only by 1G. And this guy, in my opinion, may have survived since he appeared for the picture. But if you want to take a ride in PSLV, you have to actually survive 22G. Extremely difficult. Even the fighter aircraft pilot can only manage 4 to 5G in a thing called G, 5G turnings. So if it goes beyond 5G, the blood would ooze out from his ears. So we are talking about 22G unimaginable vibrational forces the instrument has to face. What instrument it is? It is an instrument so fragile. Can you have a look at the instrument? Very, very fragile. And this is actually the drawing shown. You see all the harness. You see, can you see this? So slick. So how do you make it work? Fortunately, those people with mechanical engineering will know, there is a program called ANSYS, which actually tells you that whatever is the material, whatever is the condition, how do you reinforce? So ANSYS is a program which is available today, which is coming for the past 5 years. Otherwise, ISRO had its own programs, its own codes, which would tell us the best way to actually hold mechanically or dynamically in a proper shape. So that team actually worked wonders. So what they said is, if this is your probe, the color, this red coloration is the reinforcement. Can you see there one more sectorial corners? These are another reinforcement. Green color is another reinforcement. So the one which is bare like this, dressed up beautifully like here, see the dressing up, and then it is ready to face vibration, 22G vibration of PSLV. Yes, that helped a lot. I didn't show some more slides anyway. I just want to rush here. Okay, now apart from that, I think I'll just come back to another slide after whatever we have achieved. Another thing was, most of the instruments today work with PC. We have to remove the PC. So PC removal was extremely difficult. So there were things called serial sniffer softwares, which my team members evoked, because these are very bright software electronics engineers. So we found out what is going on between computer and this, and then put it in the chip. And the reinforcement was so strong, we went up to 30G and it worked. It is an amazing effort. But in fact, my colleagues in Europe was also saying, see Maqbool, your instrument will never work above 15G, because most of their instruments failed at 15G. This guy went up to 30G. And the whole instrument worked 22G, absolutely no problem. And then there is a thing called thermo vacuum test. There is a thing called accelerated space qualification test, in which you take the instrument 0 to 60 degrees, sorry, you take it for 8 days, you just take it in a rush of temperature going down to 0 degrees, again another rush to 60 degrees, hold it there and immediately switch on the instrument and see whether it's working. Then again like that. So that accelerated test, presently the instrument is sitting outside just to say that it is alive. So you take it inside, keep on hammering and take it out and see whether it is 8 days it was in. In fact, while it was in, we will know that it is working or not. 8 days it went through the very stringent test and passed.
What is the frequency?
Frequency of? No, this there is a well-laid program by the thermo vacuum thermal engineering people. What they say is, to be able to have an accelerated test of, let's say, Chandrayaan was planned for 2 years. What is the program I go through? I run it for a cycle called, let's say, 6 hours cold, and then immediately come down to 4 hours hot, and then like that. So there was a well-laid program. As it comes closer and closer in the 8th day, the thing will become much and much narrower. So it is as per their plan, it has to work. Now this is the picture where I was just telling Srinivasanji that after just few days before, this is on 15th August 2008, this picture should not be shown to ISRO, because I am carrying a flight model in my lap, which was actually integrated with the spacecraft, and being 15th August, my children had brought tricolors, and this is the guy with me. We got very exhausted after working 3 days and nights continuously, because the instrument stopped working just 3 days before to be delivered. And then we were awake all those 3 days, I was mentioning to him also. And on the way to a delivery station, which was 25 kilometers away, my home had come. So we just wanted to have a tea and then go. So we took this picture. So flight model in our labs. Okay, so what did we do? This was for laboratory applications, the instrument was there. It could operate only at 40 degrees centigrade in air, but with this much of weight and power, and runs with a PC. We developed a system which is space qualified. Temperature range 0 to 65 degrees in vacuum, absolutely no problem. Vibration force it can withstand. Weight has gone up a bit because we have increased, and power is 28 watts. It will work as standalone. And can you see the instrument? There are ribs, and it's all made out of one aluminum block. The weight of the actual body was around 400 grams. So the people said that if you use magnesium and that too, there will not be any, if I have to make this, I would have used magnesium strips here, another strip, and then put screws and then assemble. No, it's not assembled that way. The whole thing has been milled. The material has been removed, magnesium material, except barring this particular plate. Since this plate was standalone, it was to go on its own. So ribs were given. Ribs were given. Now, in the history of all space missions, I had a huge table because I was addressing to this gathering. I didn't bring the huge table. Just to impress upon you that I'm having history from 70s. But let's just say the recent one which went to Jupiter, Galileo probe, Huygens probe, Cassini orbiter 97, and then Chandrayaan 1. So here is the dynamic range, sensitivity and mass. If you just pay your attention, what we got in CHASE, we got 100 times best dynamic range possible. Just check yourself, 10,000 times best sensitivity possible. And our weight is 1/3 of most of the instruments which flew. So it is a miracle which space people can look for. So now I'll just come to the results. I'll take another 15 minutes. Water on the moon, we are seeing that we never found lakes like this, which this picture is showing. We will just tell you what actually water on the moon means. Okay, so water on the moon, this is slightly detailed, but if you just come along with me, I'll just show you what are the modes by which water on the moon was found. The moon mineralogy mapper, Brownian, NASA's, remote sensing, it's a passive way, you actually take an imagery and then what you do is absorption of solar radiation takes place and then it gives signatures whether H2O OH is there. So the result was 770 parts per million, almost 0.8 gram per kilogram lunar sample water could be there, is the conjecture by them. Mini-SIR pulse hoodie setup. Remote sensing, as I told you, that microwaves were actually sent and then probed, and they found out from the circular polarization of water and ice probing by, this is by microwave, they got positive signals. Pay your attention on positive signals, and then this. CHASE method was direct measurement. It is as if you are taking a balance, going to the farm and measuring whether wheat is there, rice is there, or fruits are there. So you direct, that's called in situ measurement, on-site. Actual sampling of the environment, huge H2O signal. Nobody can ever question that whether you got the signal or not, along with many other elements. And we got the results 10^7. Remember, I was just telling you what all humanity knew. They knew that only 10^5 particles. We were saying that almost 10 to 100 to 1000 times more than humans have ever predicted is what we found. This is the paper we got. Direct evidence of water in the sunlit lunar absorption, my team, and this was published in Accept January 2010 and then published in March 2010. What we found, actually what we did was, you just see, this was a mission, we found the data, we saw almost from here as till it touched down, and a typical CHASE spectrum, I'm just showing 0 to 100 atomic mass unit. At 96 kilometers, when we were just got separated, there is a CHASE spectrum, and it is very amazing. Actually, those people with good experimental passion will be able to say that the data is absolutely clean. There is a thing called signal to noise ratio. Signal to noise ratio of thousands and thousands actually means you have no flaw in your data. It's not that I'm just trying to see that 2 to 3 times signal to noise ratio, and I'm saying yes, there is a water. No, the water is actually going out of the roof. I'll just show you another graph where it is there. So 18 and then there's 44, and we found water lunar latitude. Lunar latitude, let's say from 30 degrees south, 30 degrees south to this, we were trying to compare with other moon mineralogy mapper also, M3 profile also.
H2 variation with the latitude.
See, this is what I mean by going out of the roof. This is the actual spectrum, 14th November, 2008, all those, you can pay attention here, this is the PC from which I have actually grabbed this alt print screen and then pasted, and this is the slide from there, where on 14th November itself, the actual data division system has grabbed so much of water and then we just did little bit of data processing, and then the other graph, that is this graph was after data processing. This is the raw data which has actually appeared on 14 November 2008. Now we also got a detailed paper, sorry that I didn't actually put the other one, this is accepted in July 2010, a detailed paper. Everything whatever we found on moon has again been accepted by Planetary and Space Sciences UK. What we found is the following, complete spectrum, pay your attention here, this is just before the separation from mother spacecraft. Within a few seconds of exact time is given, 98 kilometers not this way, 40 seconds before separation, then 40 seconds after separation. So 40 seconds before and after separation, and trying to say that there is absolutely no problem, that we are trying to get something from the, there were a lot of problems which I think I would not like to go now because I'm just completing 1 hour, is that it's a pure data saying that it's lunar origin, before separation, after separation, it's all there, because if it had been other way around, then I'm saying that, well, I'm just getting it from nearby spacecraft, mother spacecraft, it's not the way. And very important message you can carry is the following, in the order of abundance, that is how, which is the topmost, you see water is, water, H2O is the topmost, carbon dioxide is second, then OH17 is third. So first, second, third, 28, fourth, fifth, sixth, seventh, eighth, ninth, tenth, like that in order, all the species. There are things such as 55, 56, 57, this is actually iron family, a lot of iron. There is a thing, a species called 94. 94, if you look into mass spectrometric data analysis, is slightly involved, because not only you can have a mother element carrying a mass, it's just like saying that 10 potatoes are one big pumpkin carrying same weight. So I can say that there are 10 potatoes are there, or I can also say, hey, there's a pumpkin. So a 94 could be a huge element, or it could be a combination of some this thing. So like that could be there. But 55, 56 are all beautiful, clean iron only. There cannot be anything beyond iron. Thanks for your attention.